Ruth was raised in a family where stories and singing were a daily ingredient of family and community life. Later, she brought what she learned out into the world, where she traveled to Great Britain, Europe, and the Near East, and collected stories, songs, children's games, and folklore, kind of like a story and song harvester. And Ruth has also collected her stories and songs from children she has worked with in different school and cultural programs, where she's been a teacher, program leader, and trainer, and since then has brought what she has harvested both in travel and from children out into many places of community. She has performed as a traditional folk ballad singer and storyteller at festivals, folk song and storytelling clubs, schools, libraries, museums, churches, and other community centers. Her Twice Upon a Time Tunefully Told programs offer performances and curriculum workshops in the art that she practices, which includes folklore customs and activities for sharing nature and honoring the earth, multicultural stories, peace stories, and community building stories. And with that, I would like to introduce to you Ruth Canonico. We look forward to seeing what she has to share. I hear something like rain coming from her hand. Please give her a warm welcome.
Do you need a 5-minute warning before 20 minutes?
Yes, okay. Probably. I hope I can see you.
You're going to sit on the stool?
When I need it.
So you need something for your home?
No, here. Right, well, here's the fun part. In November, I had 3 weeks of laryngitis. I mean, serious laryngitis. As a result, I am now in vocal therapy at Mass General Hospital. And I'm not going to be doing what I usually do, which is singing a lot and telling stories, but I'm going to try to do my best to honor the themes that are present right now, both from the theme of Martin Luther King, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and all those beautiful women and friends who are in many cities across the United States. So I normally don't use notes. I'm going to use notes. I have to do all the props that I need right now. And when I run out of speaking voice, I finish. So I said, this is obviously, I'm speaking to the choir. I can tell from applause that you've made for our first feature. Today is a powerfully significant day for America. And millions, I think millions of women and friends are galvanized to march in cities and towns across America and in England, by the way. Friends of mine are marching in England in sympathy. And before us, meaning in history, stand marches of protest and power, such as suffragettes and unions, and the marches of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and protests against powers of government that seek to deny freedom, equality. And this includes Mahatma Gandhi in India, and more recently, the Arab Spring, and very more recently, Turkey, where I saw a notice that a large group of people in Istanbul stood in silence, no signs, no nothing, just stood. And as a person who does vigils with the Merrimack Valley People for Peace and Mass Peace Action, no flags, no signs, just stood. And I remember the first time on a television, oh no, on a film that was shown to us by my theater arts director, who was very impressed by Quakers. This is back in Nixon's day. He showed a very similar thing with a much smaller group of Quakers who just stood facing the Capitol. No signs, nothing, just stood. And that really impressed me. But today, I hope the women enjoy wearing their pink kitty cat hats, they're calling them pussy hats, or carrying signs or doing whatever they want to do to just stand for the freedom and equality that they and we all deserve. Now, my story has been somewhat elaborately explained from my notes to Cheryl. Makes I sit and listen to it, and I thought, gee, did I do all of that? I did, okay. So I don't have to go over that again, you already know. My main love is storytelling and folklore presentations with children and families, and I mean children as young as three, and right up to sort of the fifth grade in general, but then also with their families. And then more recently, I became a senior some while ago, and I live in a senior residence, so I started to develop senior storytelling, which I call Storytelling Tees, in which I invite the members of the audience to bring photographs of themselves and their moms and, you know, a few pictures that they, if they feel like it, can talk about their own personal stories. So that's what I do for that. So before I move on to the theme set for today, the life and legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and all the remarkable leaders of peace and justice the world over, I want to, I'm having to skip a lot. I want to mention that my real learning experience, it wasn't so much that the children taught me stories, they taught me their life, was when I came back from 20 years in England, and the last 8 years that I was there, mostly in a very beautiful but very Caucasian, white, British, rural area of England in the county of Devon. I came back to America and first started working as an assistant in the classroom with children with disabilities in Brookline, where they had proudly announced that there were 37 cultures represented in that one school. And then I went for an interview for a job which I thought was going to be to assist someone I had met who ran the preschool day nursery in the Roxbury Tobin Community Center in the Mission Hill area. And literally 1 minute before I walked into the interview, he said, "Oh no, you're not going to work with me. They want you to run the after school program." So I had to shift gears. I prepared myself to talk about preschoolers. And this wonderful director, Ron Bell, asked me a lot of questions. And the more I sat there and realized I'd be taking on helping the children after school with homework, with cultural ideas, with whatever I could do in a community I had never, ever worked in and had almost no experience, I said to him, "Well, wouldn't you rather have someone from your own community working here?" You know, I was trying to find the politically correct thing to say, "your own community." And he looked at me and he said, "What do you think about that?" He's very good at interviews. So I said, "Well, I think children are children, and I will do my best to work with them as I've done before in programs with children, age appropriately and in terms of their needs. But also I realize I'm new to this community, so I will do what I can to learn about the community where I'm working 5 afternoons a week." I got the job. So there began my education with working in the community that we now call and hear called really righteously Black Lives Matters. I mean, I didn't have that in my head then. But right, I'll tell you this, that right before I went into this job, I was staying in a flat, an apartment in Jamaica Plain. I had not known the person. This was not a rented accommodation to start with. I was just staying there. And people who lived upstairs, the gentleman was a member of the board of the Tobin Community Center, Roxbury Mission Hill. He was my color. And he said, "It's a terrible thing that just happened last year in October, that there was a little six-year-old boy going out for trick-or-treating on Halloween with his older brothers and sisters. And he was crossing the schoolyard next to the Tobin Community Center, and there was a gang fight between two gangs, and the child was shot and killed." Not an experience that I had much knowledge of in my own life, and I thought, "Good Lord, and I'm working in that center. I have a huge responsibility to these children and these families to somehow learn from them but proffer peace." Whilst I was there, I had a wonderful help from a man called Ed Pazanis, who was the inclusion specialist for the umbrella Boston Community Centers, which covered all the community centers that had after-school programs in Boston, but quite a lot of them in Dorchester, Roxbury, Mission Hill, Jamaica Plain, and these areas. And he introduced me to people that would be very helpful to me to help these children. And one of the things I learned was about the poetry of the children who live in the Roxbury Mission Hill area. And I was presented with this book called Life Thoughts. It was actually published in 1994. It's an anthology of poetry written by Roxbury youth, edited by Susan Roberts and Ted Thomas Jr. So rather than do my stories, I'm going to read a few of their poems about their lives. I'm not sure what their prompts were, but I think the prompts come out as you hear it. The first one is called Jeff, and it's by Jamed Evans. Jeff, I remember you and the times we had. I remember you and our talks. I remember the highs and buys. I remember the tears and cries. I remember the shouts and songs. I will remember you long after you're gone. I remember the features on you I dislike. I remember the time you disrespected me. I remember the day you set me free. I remember everything said about you. I remember how your death made everyone feel blue. I remember admiring your gear. I remember the first tear. I remember all the disbelief and fright. I remember the early morning blunt. I remember all your silly stunts. I remember lots about you. Should I go on? Do you need more proof? I remember the times you used my phone. When I remember everyone felt alone. I remember you don't know how special someone is until they're gone. I remember what that boy did too. Well, that was wrong. So that was one of the young men, children in the area. Then there's another poem by Rainice Salters called When I Was 14. They grow up pretty fast in that neighborhood, I'll tell you. When I was 14 years old, my enemy, Toya, and I got into a fight at Roxbury Crossing, and she stabbed me in the neck. Now I hate her. So when I think about life, I think that not everyone is your friend and should not trust everyone that you meet. That's it. I was at a community meeting at the Roxbury Tobin Center in Mission Hill, and I had worked there for a while and had developed a rapport with the children, and I felt we were getting on. And there was a community meeting, so a lot of parents came, and I stayed afterward. I usually finished at 6. And the police were talking about safety in the neighborhood. And some of the parents who had grown up there started talking about some of their experiences, which were not dissimilar from this or from the fear of violence. I was so terrified that I suddenly realized where I was, and I asked a policeman to drive me to the tube station, the T station, which was a 4-minute walk. We're not prepared, a lot of us, for this kind of experience that these children have every day. I'd like to finish with Who Are You by Aja Denby. Because of time, I can't read all the ones I liked. Who are you? Someone asked me one day. I'm Aja. I know, I heard the voice say. Define yourself and what you mean. Not your name, but your game and how you're seen. I understood then, so I said with a smile, my ways are simple, just watch for a while. He watched and he watched, quite confused, I must say. Confusion is good. I sat back out of the way. This poem's not to define me, but to make you think. Accept me, don't change me, it's what I've tried to say. We're all very special in our own little way. Just sit back and look, you'll find it one day. I don't know where this book can be found, but books like this, 1994 or 2017, they are just absolutely powerful, stories of the lives of children in these areas of Boston. Another group that I met when I was there was the Cooperative Artists Institute. Sounds very formal. It was four friends. It was an interracial team that brought programs to schools and after-school programs in the region that I mentioned, and how to do conflict resolution and community building. And that's where I met what most of us know about now, because I was there in 96, 95, 96, 97, was talking stick. And this is an actual replica of a Native American talking stick. I didn't have this when I was there. But in case you don't know how it works, you have the children in a circle. You might have some questions. You can do it for introductions. You can do it for conflict resolution. You can do it for community building, storytelling, whatever. But if you have a question to ask everyone in the group, sometimes you just put the story stick on the floor, and a person will go forward when they're ready to speak. And in my case, I found that the rain stick worked very well, which I'd used in storytelling, because it gives a sense of time passing. And that way, I would say, okay, this question is four turns of the stick. So they would be able to answer whatever they wanted to or speak to whatever they needed to with four turns of the stick. This is more for questions of introduction. When they were doing something which was more conflict resolution, there'd been a fight or something like that in the group, or there was some bad words said back and forth between children, I had an assistant care worker and a peer leader, so sometimes I would take the children into a little side room and we would do talking back and forth. We'd use something that didn't make noise, like a talking stick. And I'd say, I need to hear each of you tell me what your side of it is, what happened in the way you felt. So then they would say, and I said, and nobody's interrupting. The person holding the stick is the only person talking. I would allow more time on a clock for that. And so they would do that, and they would give their story. And I could see sometimes the reaction in the other child, you know, that was completely wrong, but they had to learn to control that. And then I'd say, okay, that's good, time's up. And then let's hear what the other person's experience was of this. And they would say their experience. Then my job as the moderator was to say, this is what I'm hearing. Am I hearing this correctly? So we'd go back and forth a few times. And I found that just the case of being able to be listened to and validated for their feeling about what was happening was already the beginning of the healing and the reconciliation. I'm not saying it was perfect. I'm not saying it was every time. But I'm certainly saying it helped. So moving on, I just wanted to mention that, again, with the help of my friend Ed Pazanese, who I admire very much for his work. He's now working mainly with children with disabilities, with arts in Boston. He said, take them out to the Museum of Fine Arts. If you can imagine, two people with nearly 20 very lively, unpredictable children and walking down to the T from Roxbury, if you know Boston, Roxbury, Mission Hill, and Tobin, down the street to the Green Line to go anywhere. By the way, for those of you who have worked in community centers, I had this much money given to me for anything. I had zero money to spend on these children for supplies or anything. So we went to the Museum of Fine Arts. We went further to the African American Museum. We went as far as the Cambridge Multicultural Arts Center when the Peace Commissioner was there to talk to kids. We saw a display of guns into art made with plastic guns cut in half and a huge peace sign and various things. We saw an exhibition of photographs going around the world from children who were refugees in refugee camps from Bosnia. And the children got to write in English comments, put it in an envelope, was then translated and brought to the children who they were looking at the pictures of. So going back again to the subject of people who have inspired me and have inspired many of us. When I was at university, at State University of New York at Stony Brook, I'm talking about the late 60s, early 70s, the first Black Studies course started and I wanted to be in it. And it was taught by Kofi Awuna, who was the Poet Laureate of Ghana, and had a beautiful, rich English British accent. And he introduced us to two people that I remember very strongly. One was Chinua Achebe. I may be saying this wrong, forgive me. And his book, Things Fall Apart, about what happened when missionaries came into his village and tried to convert people to Christianity from their own beliefs. And then the other was, of course, the beautiful, wonderful, incredible Maya Angelou's book, I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings. So in keeping with my deep respect and admiration for her, I'll read a very, very well-known but beautiful poem. I'm not her, but try to think of her as I speak it. You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may tread me in the very dirt, but still, like dust, I'll rise. Does my sassiness upset you? Why are you beset with gloom? 'Cause I walk like I've got oil wells pumping in my living room. Like the moons and like suns, with the certainty of tides, just like hope springing high, still I'll rise. Did you want to see me broken, bowed head and lowered eyes, shoulders falling down like teardrops, weakened by my soulful cries? Does my haughtiness offend you? Don't you take it awful hard, 'cause I laugh like I got gold mines digging in my backyard. You may shoot me with your words, you may cut me with your eyes, you may kill me with your hatefulness, but still, like air, I rise. Does my sexiness upset you? Does it come as a surprise that I dance like I've got diamonds at the meeting of my thighs? Out of the huts of history's shame I rise. Up from the past that's rooted in pain I rise. I'm a black ocean leaping and wide, welling and swelling, I bear in the tide, leaving behind nights of terror and fear, I rise. Into a daybreak that's wondrously clear, I rise. Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave, I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise. Maya Angelou. 2 minutes? 3 minutes. Well, because I always write more than I can actually present, and I've talked longer than I expect, I will end with a song that I sang, which was my introduction in a way to Cheryl Perrault, who gave an honoring to Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Some years ago in the Hoppington Library. And I'm going to pray that I can get this song out, and you can join me, and that will help a little if you know the words. Dr. Martin Luther King, to me, was so many things and so many things to so many people, but he begins as a Christian preacher, a Christian minister, with a doctorate, apparently. And his power of preaching was one thing that stays with me, so I'll sing his favorite song that, in fact, was probably sung to him the night before he died. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on through the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Amen.
Hello, Hopkington.
Hello.
There you go. Being as this is my first time at the Hopkington Open Mic, allow me to introduce myself. My name is Ed Bannett, and I'm a walking minstrel. I like to make people laugh, so I go around telling stories, reciting poetry, telling jokes. I can even entertain you on the piano, and I've been known to sing a song or two. My only compensation is if I can put a smile on your face, a song in your heart, and a spring in your step. Today, I'd like to entertain you with a poem that I wrote over 52 years ago to my beloved wife, Claire, now recently deceased. It's a love poem. Sort of like a Valentine, but I don't think I gave it to her on Valentine's Day. The main thing about this poem is that it expresses my love for my wife so perfectly that I hope you'll forgive me if I get emotional when I read it to you. The name of this poem is My Thoughts. Now, my thoughts could very well be your thoughts. So as I recite this poem, I would like you to think of somebody that you love very much. Could be a spouse, a significant other, a son or a daughter, a sister or brother, a parent, grandparent, an uncle or an aunt, or even a close friend. It could even be someone who has recently passed away whom you miss tremendously. My thoughts. My thoughts go out like messengers, swiftly on their way, bearing precious gifts to you each moment of the day. Ceaselessly I send them forth. Untiringly they bring the love that pours forth from my heart in a never-ending spring. With trumpets to precede them, and songs of joy and gladness, they enter in and bring the word. 'Twill be an end to sadness. For though distance is between us, and miles keep us apart, no space could e'er exceed the love that occupies my heart. So receive these thoughts with gladness. May they fill your days with pleasure. For the joy you've given me, my love, exceeds all boundless measure. Thank you very much.
Peach and pear.